Welcome back, everybody, to another exciting episode of Full Circle. I'm your host, Odo Harmon Jr. You can find me at Odo Harmon Jr. on all your favorite social medias, minus the ones I'm not on, but oh well.
And I'm Jared Fradette. You can find me at all your favorite social medias and your least favorite social medias at Toon Velo. We have another exciting episode for you today. We'll be discussing music again, another musical episode. This will be our favorite original songs from video games.
I like how you did that.
Thank you.
Very nice, very nice. We'll also be talking about Black Excellent. Yes, people, it is February. It is Black History Month, so we're going to talk about your favorite black people, or let's be honest, ones you probably know exist from all areas of geekdom. They are highly important and have done some amazing things.
And first and foremost, this is also February Valentine's Day. So I'm gonna. So what can you do, I don't know, if you're single or if you like staying at home, Netflix and chill? Basically, there's a few Valentine's specials out, or things that Netflix has put out around Valentine's Day, whether it be romantic or not.
So I saw this funny post the other day.
Yeah, yeah.
And it said that, remember back in the day, Netflix and chill was cool. It was like, let's come over, let's watch this crappy, uninspiring film that came out 20 years ago and get it on. Now it's like,
shut. What are they saying?
Yeah, it's like, I'm on part 5 of this awesome documentary series.
You watched without me? I'm only in episode 4. How could you do this to me?
And I was like, I just think that's hilarious. It went from like just background noise to like, wait, no.
This is important. So Big Mouth has released their Valentine's Day episode already. It's kind of a two-part, hour-long episode. If you haven't known what Big Mouth is, it's a cartoon that tackles, it's a coming of age, and it kind of tackles puberty.
Very mature, by the way, I think.
Super mature.
It is not for children in any capacity.
If you're squeamish, don't do it. You have to be of a certain maturity because they are completely blatant about displaying everything related to puberty.
Everything.
But, you know, there is some crude humor, but it's those things that we all went through.
It's crude, but it's also clever and refined. That's, you know, it's not crude for the sake of
being crude.
Yeah.
Right. And so this episode, of course, focuses on Valentine's Day, and all the kids are trying to either go on dates or get dates or reconcile the fact that they are, in fact, lonely, and how there is no fate worse in the world than being a young teenager alone on Valentine's Day. I mean, we laugh, but there are several most adults feel the same way.
Oh, no, I remember in high school, like, it was either 9th or 10th grade, because our school was split up.
Uh-huh.
I'm just going to say freshman year, because it makes the story that much more entertaining.
Right.
They remember when they sold, like, the little roses you could buy for, like, $1, and you could, like, send them to, like, someone. I did that, and I, even though the person didn't have to be there, just physically going to the table, writing her name down, and, like, sending it away.
Because then the table people knew, everybody at lunch knew.
Yeah, it was just...
And none for Gretchen Wieners. It happened. It's a real thing that happens.
Yeah, but I look back on it, it was like, that was just so simple to just like give them the $5 and write a name down and leave. But in my mind, it was like, lunch is already like halfway over. And I'm just like, I still haven't done it. And then like, now that it's halfway over, now a lot of people aren't at the table. So now it's more even a spectacle, you know, in my mind. I'm like, but realistically, no one probably cared.
You have to either somehow leave class early and get there before the lunch rush begins, or wait till everybody's leaving and do it like quickly in the transactional crowd. That's how this works out here. But it's great. Big Math.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. That is kind of a loose segment anyway. This sort of like the Chilling Adventures of Sabrina, the Yule Log episode. You know, because this isn't because Netflix doesn't produce episodes throughout a regular season like TV does. They drop them one night so you can binge watch them all right before you have to record a podcast. You know, so they don't have those episodes normally scheduled out for the holidays.
Yeah.
But I think they're kind of starting to either do that or they will be in the future, right?
Or I guess they could just tell them to make a holiday episode and it just won't premiere with the season. It'll just come out said holiday.
Right. And that's kind of what both of these episodes were, given that they seem to be canon with the rest of the series. They pick up exactly where the series left out. This isn't some ambiguous time in the middle. You know, it's not like a random flashback like Black Clover is doing. Oh, yeah, I know Asta has lost all his arms, but remember that time back 20 years ago when he hadn't lost his arms? And then like new arc begins. I'm like,
all right, I know we're going on a super tangent here, but I appreciate that because in the manga, when they met the old guy, they didn't explain how he knew him. They're just like, hey, guy from my past, let us help Asta. And I was just like, how do they know this guy? But in the anime, they went back and like, I was like, thank you, anime. The manga just said, yeah, we know this people.
Black Clover is always kind of on thin ice with me, so any sort of like break in the story really irks me the wrong way.
But I promise you, it would have irked you even more if it just would have kept going without that flashback, and then you'd have been like, who are these three people and why are they important?
No, for Black Clover, I'm fine with that.
All right, that's fair.
There is only one plot in my mind. Where is this going? Anywho. So, all that being said, if you do not want to deal with Black Mouth, whoops. Skipping ahead to the next segment, Black Excellence / Thinking of Current Political Times, but we're not that kind of show. Big Mouth. If you don't want to see Big Mouth because of it is rather mature, not a Valentine's Day episode, but Russian Doll. You've probably heard people talking about it. You should watch it. Now, I don't want to spoil it because I think it's really best that you watch it on your own to get it through. But it's a Groundhog's Day mystery drama.
Ooh.
Yes. It has nothing to do with Russia. Again, we're not that kind of podcast. So, you know, it follows Nadia, a New York woman who is reliving her birthday day. And why is that? Who knows?
You know, I've always told myself I would never want to be stuck in that loop because I'm going to be the person that, like, on day three, I'm already going to be at the point that it takes them, like, a while to get, like, I'm just going to, like, screw with everything and, like, go balls to the walls. And I'm like, and no, I mean, my day three is just the end of the loop and now I just got to live with my decision. Like, right. That would just be me.
Like, how many times do you have to loop before you give up on consequences?
Yeah, like, me, it wouldn't take me that long at all. Like, and I swear in all these, it takes them, like, a good month of reliving the same thing. I'm like, bro, I would have been there within the first week.
Right?
Like, within the first week, I would have been living without consequence. But knowing me, because I feel like the loop logic would be like, oh, he's already there. Nope, loop over. Ha ha.
But how also would it take you to realize that you're in a loop?
One day. One day.
I do have to appreciate there's an episode of Space Dandy where they're stuck in a loop, and the narrator's like, so I know we're skipping to the point where they realize they're in a loop.
Oh, it took them like months.
But it was like 3 months. Yeah. And they're like, hey, wait a second.
I remember that. It would take me one day. First of all, I think I would notice that the day hasn't changed. Like, if I especially went to work and everything, and it was just like, hey, everybody, today's April Tuesday, whatever day. And
you're like, it's not. It would take me one,
especially that heavy deja vu. It would be like, hey, because a normal human being routine isn't so similar that they can't distinguish Tuesday from Wednesday from Thursday.
Right.
I do slightly different things. They'll be like, oh, I did this yesterday. Let me continue. And then it'll be like, whoa, you know, my actions of yesterday have not carried over into today. And everyone is having the exact same conversation at the exact same time.
I would say because of that also, so Nadia, she figures it out. She's in a loop pretty darn quick. Okay.
Good for her.
Yeah. That's just so fun. She's like sassy and intelligent.
Wait, and it's your birthday. Of course you.
That's a kind of a pretty big clue. Yeah.
Ooh. So Valentine's Day special is for geeky Valentine's dates. Go to cons and this is just a segment. It's arbitrary, people. It's the holiday. I don't know. My favorite geeky couple, Green Lantern and Hawk Girl.
That's like only Justice League Unlimited.
I don't care.
You know what? Let's go ahead and spin this since you made this great transition. Yes. We're going to spin this into Black Excellence and Black History Month. So, starting off.
We will be discussing Phil Lamar, who is a voice actor for, you guessed it, John Stewart, the Green Lantern in Justice League.
And holy voice acting of anime Japan. The voice of Hermie Conrad as well. I just stretched that. There's very few words or cities that end with actor or acting, or I don't know, if you have a better one, please, because I was searching for like 20 minutes trying to come up with something.
Oh, that's what you were doing.
That's what I was doing.
Okay.
Holy voice acting of Port Lebastian. I don't know, it doesn't really work.
I mean, you tried.
Yeah.
But yes, Phil Lamar, he voice acted things in anime, video games, and you guessed it, cartoons. because I don't think you can voice act in a live action show. This just acting.
Is that what Bradley Cooper does for Rocket Raccoon?
Oh well, you're the first one to admit that is the Avengers live action.
It's more live action than the upcoming Lion King film.
Oh, okay. Granted, the Lion King is 0% live action.
Even Beauty and the Beast had Emma Watson and no one else.
I did not find her that appealing of an actor.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Actor. Is actor gender neutral?
I think both women and men prefer the term actor now.
Okay, yeah. I'm not that fond of her as an actor.
Well, are you enamored with Harry Potter as a series?
No.
There you go.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, but yeah, Phil Lamar. So he's done things from Johnny Bravo, Powerpuff Girls, the Mr. T cartoon, Class of 3000, the Metal Gear Solid series. He was Vamp. Pretty much, he was on Hey Arnold. So pretty much every Nickelodeon, Disney Channel. He's in Star vs. the Forces of Evil. So yeah, it's if you've ever watched a cartoon, you've heard his voice.
It's great.
So yeah, so round of applause for Phil Lamar. Oh, you're cheeky.
Yeah. Tricky. Okay, so I'll give a huge shout out now to Sonic Fox. I feel we probably should have talked about him beforehand.
They're definitely after this Game Awards speech, but yeah, Sonic Fox.
Right? He is black, he is gay, he is a furry, basically everything a conservative would hate. We're not that kind of podcast.
We are not that kind of podcast. You know, we've been saying that a lot lately. Not this episode, I felt like that was last episode too.
Well, it's the weird crux where like the zeitgeist and pop culture is just, they keep overlapping.
I mean, our current president has completely destroyed the boundary between pop culture, entertainment, and politics. It's kind of like just went out the window.
Big old smear, right? But yeah, so he is big, he's a winner, he's the current reigning champion of several DBZ fighting games, as well as other fighting games.
Yeah, I think
games.
Mortal Kombat 11 and DBZ, he's the current champion.
Mm-hmm.
DBZ Fighters.
Yes. Fighters. Yeah, so big shout out to him, congratulations again.
I mean, to be black, gay, and furry, and open about all these things. I'm not saying you have to be the best at everything you've ever done, but damn, you probably have to be the best.
The bar is really, really high there, and just jumped right over it. He did it with grace and excellence.
And he did. So, what was it? A round of applause?
Round of applause.
So, next on our list, and without this man, our podcast probably would not exist, and probably one of the world's greatest pastimes and hobbies would not exist.
Our good giveaway here would not exist.
So, and thanks to the man, Jerry Lawson, there we go. He's an engineer from New York City, and he invented the first video game console and interchangeable cartridge. So, you know, when you take out it would not exist without him. He invented that. Some people would argue he's the father of video games, not in a he invented the concept of video games sense, but without him, we literally wouldn't have had the Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Sega Genesis, Atari, any cartridge-based video game system at all.
He made it viable, right?
Yeah, and so that's, in the terms of inventions, you know, to create, you know, interchangeable cartridges with data that holds games, or I guess whatever you want to put on them.
It seems so blasé now, but
yeah.
Remember the like punch card system? Ugh. Computers the size of rooms. Ugh.
So yeah, so like many great inventors, because you know time and I don't know injustice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, many people don't know he exists, but by God, that is a great invention. You know, I guess in science too, really, because even beyond video games, that concept, fact that it didn't exist prior, is just
The SD card, the jump drive, like any sort of portable data stick.
Yeah, so
I feel he is the father of
pretty much. Yeah.
Yeah.
So look him up, be educated. You know, if you're forced to do a Black History project, this is a real good one because, you know, it's not your typical Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King. They are very viable people, but you know, we've all heard it. This will be one of those more
did you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. So this next one I like for numerous reasons, including the fact that it itself is sort of a full circle effect.
Okay.
Right, so Mae Jemison, she was the first black female astronaut, right? She was inspired because she saw Nichelle Nichols on Star Trek, right? Lieutenant Uhura.
Ah.
Right? So she was the first to go into space. She, of course, has her all her accolades, all her honorary doctorates and things. But then also after that, she went on to be on Star Trek The Next Generation.
Oh.
Yeah. So a nice little full circle thing there.
Full circle.
Being the first actual astronaut to be on the show.
Oh, man. So.
Yeah, double whammy there.
And she's just like knocking it out the park on all cylinders.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like that would be kind of cheeky. It's just like, yeah, that's cute. That's what they think happens in space. Like, as you're on Star Trek, it's like, oh, man, our anti-gravity. I mean, I'm pretty sure she wasn't pompous, but I feel like in my mind, I would be, like, I guess, like.
I was going to say, if I was an actor, I'd be like, I feel like I'm sorry for having to say this around you because I know this is stupid, but can you reverse the polarity over there? Just like, this got to be, it's all tongue-in-cheek a little bit.
Or what was the opposite effect? She was like, my God, how did they know so much? They got it so
right. Including these consoles that don't move.
She's like, because in space you can't press buttons. I'm pretty sure you can. They do it. They have to.
Mm-hmm.
But have we ever been to space here? I mean, Earth is... No, we're not
that kind of show.
All right, who is our last person, Jared?
So last, this is maybe a little cheeky. This is the entire Black Panther movie. It just set so many records. It was a big celebration of African culture, right? I'll just read some of their accolades, right? They've gotten so far 7 nominations for the Academy Awards, of which they are the first superhero movie to receive a nomination for Best Picture.
Oh, yeah.
Right, so every Marvel movie you've loved up to this point, not a single one was nominated for Best Picture. They are. They've got 3 nominations for the Golden Globes, 2 wins at the Screen Actors Guild Awards, and 12 nominations by the Critics' Choice Awards. And I don't know if those award ceremonies have come and gone yet. I don't think so.
I don't know. I always feel that, like, all those award shows happen at, like, a weird time. It's like, we're in March. Time for the 2018 awards. Why?
Yeah, I don't know.
What?
I'm told things like the Oscars are happening, and I'm like, cool.
Yeah, I'm like, I don't understand how we're 6 months into the new year, and we're trying to award last year.
Or worse, it's like, hey, here's the 2019 awards for February. I'm like, but it hasn't happened yet. 2019 hasn't happened yet. Why are we doing, I don't know. They're weird.
They are weird. So yeah, Black Panther, you know, it broke records. You know, and the thing I personally enjoyed about it, because, like, yeah, it was going to draw a crowd because it was quintessentially, you know, the Black superhero movie. But it, like, it stood on its own feet. You know, it didn't, like, fall into this trope of, like, you know, this is just a movie and we all know we're here for it. It's like, no, like, it can be, you know, we can have movies about Black people or any minorities and that not be the focus and it still would be great. You know, shout out to Jordan Peele for, you know, showing that to the world.
Right.
Well, yeah, which we actually already had a segment about that.
Right.
But yeah, and you know, it's like, I will say, you know, like Into the Spider-Verse, like, yeah, you know, it had heavy tones of, you know, the minority characters, but it didn't lose its focus. You know, it wasn't there to like beam you and be like, this is a minority movie. You have to appreciate it. It was like, no, it is a minority movie, but it's also just a good movie because when you see movies with white people, you don't have to feel like, oh, like.
You don't have to justify that it's a white movie.
Yeah, you're just like, it's a movie. And Black Panther, you know, and other things like it. Black Panther clearly being the most successful is like, this is still just a movie.
Right.
And yes, it deals with, you know, people other than, you know, I guess, the norm, quote unquote, for those listening.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, is there a word? It's like, not the norm, but the usual. The saturated.
Not the standard. There's on the tip of our tongue. We're going to...
We'll come back to it at some point. But yeah, so it grossed $1.3 billion worldwide. It was the number one solo superhero movie at the time, number 3 Marvel film of all time, and number 9 grossing film of all time.
Ooh, that is a lot.
Right? Like, that's just got to be, what, Titanic, Avatar, I don't know what else. And then...
I don't know. I was going to say James Cameron Avatar. I'm like, oh, that's what you meant when you said Avatar.
Alita, right? Because James Cameron... Have you noticed they aren't saying from James Cameron, they're saying from the producer of Avatar. They're already like distancing it. Anywho,
I mean, the movie looks trash. It visually looks like I'm gonna have a horrible time watching this.
And
she's so bug-eyed compared to everyone else not being bug-eyed.
Right, it's not the fact that she just has bug eyes, but literally no one else does. Literally no one else in the entire trailer has eyes as big as her.
Yeah, so it just saturates the fact that, like, she is fake and not there.
But one last fun fact for Black Panther being, so this month, right now, 2019, it's going on tour at 250 different AMC theaters.
Oh, yeah, for free, right?
For free.
Yeah.
Right? So that is to clarify, they're going to show two showings at each theater once. So they'll be at, or they'll be twice. They'll air twice in each theater, and that's it. So check your local AMC theaters to see when that's happening.
Yeah.
You can go see it for free.
For free. Free movies are always fun.
Right? Especially when it's such a great one like this. You know what I really liked in particular about the movie?
It's music.
It's music! But we're not talking about movie music. We'll be talking about
video game music. Yay! Which video game music has recently become, I don't want to say popular, but it's reached the mainstream in popularity, which, you know, things like the Kingdom Hearts Symphony, the Metal Gear Solid Symphony. Symphony of the Goddesses for Legend of Zelda. So on and so forth. The Pokemon Symphony. Pokemon Symphonic, which I don't know why. Like, I mean, I just really like that title. Pokemon Symphonic. It just makes it sound so
ritzy.
I was going to say official. Cultured. There we go.
Cultured.
So, yeah. So, video game music, you know, has reached mainstream popularity with its the Final Fantasy Symphony. Like, I'm sorry. Just there's just so many.
Right.
Which, we went to New York to actually go see the Metal Gear Symphony. But
it got canceled.
It got canceled. But it's been rescheduled. They're going to have a show in March. They're going to premiere in March.
L.A., right?
No, in New York again.
In New York.
But they're going to have a second showing in April in L.A.
In L.A.
So if you are in New York or L.A., I highly recommend you go see that because we didn't get to, sadly. And those are the only two, like, showings in, like, the world. I think one might be in Paris. Don't quote me on that.
Yeah,
petty. But definitely New York and L.A. will be the only two places in the country you can see it. And it's for, like, one day only in each city. Right. So get your black ties out, people.
So this segment specifically are musics that are original to the video game.
Yes.
So this is not, you know, Iron by Woodkid featured on Assassin's Creed. These are for the games originally.
Yes, OST people, original soundtrack.
So we're going to put on our little earbuds here so we can hear and we'll play over for you some of our songs. Do you want to go first, Odell?
Yeah, sure. So my first pick is from a little indie game called Bastion, which came out for the Xbox Live Arcade circa 2011-2012.
Okay.
And one of the things I really enjoy about this is because this was before, you know, now indie games have reached into, you know, this main of like, oh, you know, they're like the gems of the game world, you know, always great. But this was back when indie games really weren't that popular. Like, you just really had to seek them out. Even, like, finding the interface for them was hard. And so in the song, you meet a character named Zia, and you play through this level as the world's falling apart, and you hear this somber song playing as you look for her. And you can hear the track now. She's humming, she's strumming her guitar, and she's speaking of the world of ruin. And just for a game of this nature, it was just amazing to hear this in his starts.
Gonna build that city on a hill.
It's like haunting in a way.
Yeah. Well, in the context, like, there was a cataclysmic event that killed like 90% of the world.
And haunting.
And so she's literally, she doesn't know other people's alive. She's just singing. And the character you're playing as is searching for her because she's a survivor. And actually, the closer you get to her, the louder the song is.
Okay. I haven't played the game, but I kind of just instantly was taken to the imagery of Casher and Sins.
Then it is doing its job.
Right.
And yeah, so people, this is Build That Wall, aka Zia's theme from Bastion.
Nice.
What about you, sir?
So I'm actually going to just kind of go backwards in time here. My first one here will be Sands of Cirkonos from Dishonored 2. From Copilot Music and Sound, released in 2017. So, you hear this in the epilogue of the whole game at a large, but you can also hear it throughout the game. This is actually pretty important for the gameplay. One of the achievements you can unlock is visiting this duo of musicians throughout the... There it is. You can these duo musicians throughout the various levels, and they will sit here and sing various tunes, and you get an achievement for listening to the full song through all three times.
I could picture myself on the shores of Fanatica, right? Which we were, it.
We were. That was still so amazing. Then there are other songs too that I could probably include here. They're different songs, but it's the same melody. How about you? And it really just kind of underscores the entire, like, we're kind of poor, we're making it along, and that government, the empress, the false empress. There's layers to the dishonored plot line here.
You know, the thing that I like about this song, you know, it just seems like if someone saw this was like, you know, an Italian folk song, I would just instantly believe them.
Right, like, it's very much, you know, imagine yourself, you haven't played the game, you're at the docks, there are all these whalers coming in, you're the working class, and you're singing about your troubles.
Good stuff. Well, I am going to follow that up with, I'm also going to go back in time a little bit, too. This is a 16-bit classic. This is from Donkey Kong Country 2, Diddy Kong's Quest, and it's called Stickerbush Symphony. So, not only does the music match the level wonderfully, but it's a very, like, somber yet action-filled song. And the thing that's impressive, so we talked about Miyamoto before about how in The Legend of Zelda, they had to, like, reinvent a chip just so they could fit the music in there. When you think that this song is technically has a musical range of, like, A to D and, like, literally was only made with 16-bit technology, blows my mind. They're like, imagine, you know, if they had the symphonic version of this, how much better it would have sounded. And, like, you know, it starts off with this little beeps and boops, you know, ambient noises, and then it just really picks up, and, you know, it just gets you going. And it's one of those levels where it's just, like, the music's so good, but, like, the level itself is extremely hard. It almost keeps you going.
That weird kind of split, you're like, okay, now, here we go. Okay, we got this.
Yeah, you're like, all right. Because, you know, I feel like certain music in a game can just either make you feel horrible about yourself or just keep you going. And this one definitely falls and keep you going. So right now, it's still very much, you know, in its startup. And then when it starts up, you know, the horns start blaring, which, I mean, there's no actual horns. Right. But
this actually, it's going to sound really obvious out loud. It reminds me of a KK Slider from Animal Crossing. Right, they kind of returned this 8-bit sound, and they managed to produce a lot of interesting music off of that.
And, you know, I guess, like, since we're both musically inclined, just from years of band and other things, like, I just want to see, like, ourselves, like, just given the range of, like, you know, 8-bit or 16-bit, what could we actually produce? Can we produce anything of...
Take that, all 6th grade bands. Silly little Louie. Buh, buh, buh. Buh, 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 buh. No, you can do better. People can do a lot better with a limited range. Range is not a...
crutch?
It's not a crutch.
And insert your dishate of all the songs in Frozen.
No, that was a different issue. She does not have the range.
Okay. So I'm just going to fast forward the song here a little bit so we can just get to the point. You know what?
You at home will hear this.
It is too long for our segment. So speaking of that, my next song is from Metal Gear Solid, actually, and they will be performing the song to Metal Gear Symphony, is from Metal Gear Solid 3, Snake Eater, which it has an espionage James Bond feel, so they created what would be essentially like a James Bond song for a game, complete with lyrics, and... You can hear it now. It's sung originally by a woman by the name of Cynthia Harrell. And, can you feel the James Bond?
Oh, no, totally. Like, I can't sing and listen at the same time, but there is a James Bond song I'm specifically thinking of that it seems to parallel a lot. Darling, I'm done. You've won. Martinis, girls, and gun. It's murder on our love affair.
And then, so I love this part because then, you know, it has the very, like, cocktail reachers in a dark, dirty bar.
Oh, no, this is completely like the guns. Gun, gun, gun. But instead of bullets, it's like women coming out. But then they don't kill anything. They just, like, they land in a pile of, like, cards and then fall away to reveal the logo of, like, someone's eye.
So, funny, in the game, as she's singing the song, that's exactly what's happening. So, and here's the best part. So, the credits of the people name are moving like a snake across the screen. And, you know, it has, like, you know, bombs exploding and people doing that. And then, like, him drawing his weapon and then falling down a spiral of the barrel. And it's like... So, besides the song, the visuals that go on during the song are just, you know,
complete the package. Yeah.
And I personally think, even on its own, just merit without playing the game, the lyrics are some of the lyrics are kind of kooky, like eating on a tree falls, you know, you do that in the game. I still think it's a good song on its own merit. And it actually has a jazz rendition that's 6 minutes long, and it is amazing.
That sounds amazing.
So, yes, it has a very James Bondy feel.
So, my next song is actually a James Bond. It's just from the game Everything or Nothing, song Everything or Nothing. I actually wanted to use a different song from the game Nightfire, but that is one of the songs that was... It wasn't composed for the game. It just matched, so they brought it on as the title sequence. So I could not use that one.
Yeah, so when you first told me this, I honestly thought that was just a James Bond movie called Everything or Nothing. Is there? There is, right?
Yeah, sorry. When I have songs in my ear, I find it hard to think of other words.
But like you said, this song was made for the game Everything or Nothing, not a James Bond movie Everything or Nothing.
Right. My instinct is to say no. Everything... I think you're thinking of, like, Tomorrow Never Dies.
Ah, that's what it is.
Yeah. Yeah, because it's only the game that shows up when you search for that.
So this is very much a James Bond song, but, like, through and through and through. And I have to think, they're like, hey, we need you to make a song for the new James Bond, Everything or Nothing. Game.
Oh. Which I need to actually look up because, like, classically for the movies, all the artists are only ever English or British, because I think... Well,
Tina Turner sang the song for GoldenEye.
But that's
the movie.
Is that the movie?
Yeah, the movie. I promise you she did.
Okay, I need to look this up because... hang on.
Not to have anything against the Brits. This whole world has been a lie up to this point.
Like, yeah, GoldenEye. I'm like, no, I don't. I get that's the thing. I don't want to hear the thing. I want to hear the information about it. Well, yeah. Then. She holds a high honor amongst... No, okay. Yeah. Color me wrong. You got me.
Look, that's our After Effects of me coloring you wrong.
Oh, wait, you're editing the segment?
I am not.
No, I was trying to think of, like, because I was actually thinking of Shirley Bassey as Welsh. She's not specifically English.
You know, speaking of the English singer singing, I love Adele and almost everything she sings, but I did not like the song for Skyfall.
Really?
I like it, but I just feel like Adele's so much better than that. It was just more like a song not written for her. It was a song they wrote and just asked her to sing.
Possibly. That might be the case.
And I just feel like if they would have went in with the mindset that Adele is going to sing this song,
it could have been different.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so my next one. So, since I'm not allowed to just say all the music from Legend of Zelda, which would just be on this list, and I also can't just say all of the Wind Waker, which I think, of all the games, has the best music overall.
I can see that.
Right. My overall favorite song, hands down, is Gerudo Valley, Ocarina of Time. Koji Kondo. Du-du-du. You know you're in the desert.
You really, guitar, you really do.
Right?
And, like, this song's been covered so much in so many different ways, and it always sounds good.
Right. I'm going to get annoyingly technical here. My favorite part is any music with triplets in it. This probably won't sync up on video to audio for you.
But I mean, even if they did, I mean, how many musicians are watching this show? I mean, they're just watching you conduct. I feel like most people, when they see that, they're just moving their hands.
Right. One, two. Oh, I'm off in the song now.
So as Jared, you know, fiercely conducts this song, I will say, you know, when you do different versions of a song, sometimes it sounds different. Like if you do like Spanish guitar or like sung in a different cadence, but the essence of the song seems to never be missed, no matter what you played on. Like I said earlier, which conveys the feeling of what I said earlier about when you give a producer a song and you're like, I needed to convey this feeling, and that this song is an example of it conveyed the feeling of being in the desert, you know, bandito style, if you will.
You say even the swell and coming the swell and day crescendos here, it's like, you know, as we reach the height of the midday sun, right, it swells up and then it comes back down to just like a low guitar guitar beat again, like at night, as you would when throughout the extremes of the desert.
Yes. I'm just enjoying the music. I hope you are too.
Right. I just love anything with a 3/4, a 6/8, or a triplet feel to it.
I will say, speaking of your triplets, I'll just say they're just insanely fun to play on the xylophone and or marimba. It's one of those things because I feel like, you know, every instrument can do this is on the way, you know, especially when trumpets are doing their fanfares. But I feel like there's certain rhythms that when you play on an instrument makes it look cool. It has a visual component to what you're hearing.
Oh yeah.
So like when you're playing triplets off on, you know, it gives you the sense that everyone wants to see when someone plays off on, just the mallet's doing like this crazy like back and forth creating on the wave motion action. Alright, so for my final pick. So I'm pretty sure you heard of the indie hit Undertale. Where it's great, you should play it, point blank, period. It has a genocide route and a pacifist route. So in genocide route, you kill everything, literally everything. Pacifist, you don't kill anything. And there's like the in-between route where you kind of do a mix of both, which means you can like kill one thing or save one thing, and then you end up with that middle path. So just play the extremes. Mm-hmm. That's really what's meant to happen. And the genocide route has the hardest bosses, but they have different themes, so the good and bad side have different themes, and all the bad themes are extremely well. So on this one, you fight Undyne, and like as you kill her, her will to save the world, the human world and the monster world from you, causes her to reach a transformation, and she's like, oh, you're gonna have to try harder than that, and she comes back as this amazing heroine that's sent to stop you. And as you know, you're killing her, essentially. The song's playing, and her determination to save the world is, like, swelling, and it's just, like...
I'm now rooting for her?
Yes, like, when it happens in the game, you're like, aw, I want to lose.
Right?
Like, she, at that point in the game, she becomes the hero to you being the ultimate villain.
Which makes sense based on the paths we've taken to get here.
Yeah, so she's far from the last boss. She's, like, maybe, like, the halfway point. But at this point, it was just amazing. And, like, the game's, like, the wind is howling. Like, it sets up because it's kind of 8-bit and there's no actual real grass. So the text is setting up the scene, and it's just, like, man.
I want to describe this song as epic, but not in the sense of, like, today's version of, epic. But, like a classic and epic, like Beowulf. That's what this music is invoking to me.
Yeah. And so, right now we're watching a steal, but like her battle animation fits well with the song, and just everything about it is just great. I was gonna originally play that video, but it's gonna have like game noises in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, so again, it's called Battle Against a True Hero.
Yep.
And then like right here, you just, you know, here's like the stare down, like, you know.
So it's come to this. Yes, yeah. You can still stop. Can I? I've already come this far.
Exactly. Like, again, people... And then, you know, of course, the clash. Like, you do not understand... Even if you don't understand music, you still understand its importance, even at a subconscious level. The feelings it invokes in you, like, are, you know, purposeful. This was not by accident. It wasn't just like, oh, you know, look how this YouTube video... Look how this song mashed up with this guy dancing.
Tempo, people. Everybody uses... Anywho, that's a rant. So my final song, a little tongue-in-cheek because I've used it before. However, it's a great song.
Escape
from the City, Crush 40, Sonic Adventure 2 Battle.
Come on, sing along at home, people. You all know it. We all know it.
Yeah!
This is my favorite, like, song, the fake drum, too. Because I feel like it just hits.
Rolling around at the speed of sound. Got places to go, gotta follow my rainbow. Chasing around, have to keep moving on. Guess what lies ahead, only one way to find out. Must keep on moving ahead. No time for chasing, follow my plan instead.
I don't know,
what I thought I'd see. Take my lead, I'll set you free. Follow me, set me free. Trust me, and we will escape from the city.
You know, everyone played this game at, like, Walmart, Target. Back when you could, like, still play, like, the game. Right? And, like, every kid was just like, this, mom, this. When's it out? Is it out now? This. Birthday, Christmas, whatever. I got a B. This.
Right? No.
This is the rest great. Of the game isn't as great as this opening moment, but...
it's really not. But...
Trust your feelings, got to live and learn. It's funny because Live and Learn is the last song in the game.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I love, like, the future past this game, right? It's like, Shadow, didn't he die? Don't worry, he's better now. Okay.
Yeah, Live and Learn is, like, when you fight the last boss, that's, you know, Supersonic and
Super
Shadow. I think they call him something different. Yeah. Like, they're singing the last song called Live and Learn. I was like... So if you listen, this song ties into that song, and then Live and Learn ties back to this song. Which is a little just nice little tidbit there for you.
So, yeah.
See, I like that song because it was like as long as we were talking. Every other song was like, we're a 5 to 6 minute actual real song.
I mean, that's the tricky part about composing for video games. But I hope you enjoy these games too, these games and these music for these games.
Yeah, hopefully we learn something new about Black people and geek culture and how they've helped, you know, not only shape this country, the world, but most of the favorite things you love, even if you know it or not.
For Full Circle Podcast, I am Jerry Fradette. You can find me at Toon Valo.
And I'm Odo Harmon Jr. You can find me at Odo Harmon Jr. We didn't mention the Valentine's segment again.
It was kind of I'm gonna lean in because it's intimate here. It's a subtext here. It's an intimate experience this Valentine's Day. I don't know. Okay. There we go.
It's like what was the episode from? I was like, I'm on like a buzz.
Buzz. Welcome to public radio. I don't know. It was it really a full segment? We talked for 10 minutes about stuff.
And I guess, and we called it Valentine's Day. You know, it was a nice idea with no substance.
There we go.
Sign it off.